Bello. She is Professor Emeritus of History of Contemporary Philosophy at Lateran University in Rome and past Dean of the Faculty of Philosophy of this university. She is the President of the Italian Center of Phenomenological Researches, affiliated to the World Phenomenological Institute. She is also the President of the International Society for Phenomenology of Religion and past Director of the International Research Area dedicated to Edith Stein and Contemporary Philosophy. Among her recent books, we can put The Divine in Husserl and Other Explorations, The Sense of Things Towards a Phenomenological Realism, and Il Senso del Sacro. She is the co-editor of the Italian translation of Edith Stein's works, and her last translation is Una ricerca sullo Stato, a research on the state. She is one of the first scholars who introduced in Italy the philosophy of Edwige Konrad Martius, Edith Stein, and Gerda Walter. And so among her recent essays, we can quote The Sense of the Mystical Experience, according to Gerda Walter. And the title of her presentation today is Rethinking Edmund Husserl's and Edith Stein's Philosophy, Philosophical Anthropology and Metaphysics. So, Professor Ales Bello, the floor is yours.
I thank you very much for your kind presentation, and I am grateful for this invitation. My point is the relationship between anthropology and metaphysics in Edith Stein and Husserl. My speech is divided in two parts. The first is dedicated to Husserl, and it is wider. The second one dedicated to Edith Stein. I don't know if I have time to say what I want to say, but in any case, I prefer to speak about Husserl. Regarding the last point that was discussed between Sarah and Roberta, that is the anthropological perspective in Husserlian phenomenology. And my point, it is possible to have my paper. You see, Mariano?
Yes?
Professor Dambra will show my paper. Yes.
Okay, yeah, we can.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So, I avoid the introduction and I go straight to the first point. Can one find a philosophical phenomenological anthropology in Husserl? This is my first point. This subheading of this section allows us to ponder whether or not a philosophical anthropology can be found in Husserl's philosophy. To begin to answer this question, we must first understand the term anthropology, that the term anthropology has many senses. Edith Stein offers us a various definition, distinguishing between anthropology as a natural science, which explores the human being as being of nature, as a science of the spirit, which following Diltai, Rickert, and Windelband views the human being through its spiritual activities, and as a philosophical anthropology. Husserl discussed different terms of anthropology in two texts found in the volumes Husserliana 25, Aufsätze und Aufträge, and Husserliana 27, Aufsätze und Vorträge 2. The first text, Phenomenologie und Psychologie, written in 1917, opens with a peremptory affirmation that the phenomenon of the human being, which he intends to investigate, must not be confused with the human being studied by the natural sciences. Phenomenology is a parallel science that operates on the eidetic plane and with respect to the fields of knowledge globally understood, seeks to grasp a priori character of phenomenon, that is the idea or essential structure of animality, subjectivity, animal subjectivity, personhood, and the human sociality, all of which form the base of empirical sciences like psychology, anthropology, and other sciences, sciences of the spirit. He analyzed what he calls regional ontologies, which revolve around specific phenomena that are assumed to have an essential structure. Anthropology, in this regard, is a regional ontology. The delineation of regional ontologies corresponds to what I define the first step of phenomenological method, that is the reduction to essence, which is then followed by another step, namely the phenomenological transcendental reduction, as we know, which I will discuss later. Husserl returns to the same argument some 10 years later in a text from the 1930s, Phenomenologie und Anthropologie. The text is from lectures given at the Kant Societies, Frankfurt, Berlin, and Halle in 1931. In them, he explores the relation between phenomenology and anthropology, and in contrast with anthropologistic and psychologistic view of philosophy, Husserl proposed a field of inquiry that has a transcendental dimension at its core and center. And here he describes and uses what I call the second step of the method, more precisely the transcendental reduction. Given the context in which the aforementioned lecture was given, Husserl is addressing Kant's societies, it could be assumed that the use of the term transcendental leads to the openness towards Kant's position. But on the contrary, he establishes his distance from the letter, referring rather to Descartes, with respect to whom he emphasized his intellectual proximity and at the same time distance. Husserl makes a profound distinction between his position and Cartesian doubt, as we know, which, by putting the existence of the world into question, surpasses what lies within the realm of human possibilities. The world cannot be denied. It is so present in its existence that it cannot be doubted. It can possibly and only place it in parentheses or brackets. The epoché, therefore, is only a change of attitude, and this is very important regarding how also, for example, our living body, as we discussed before, marked by turning away from the naivety of the natural acceptance of everything that comes our way, including the already established sciences. It leads to change the perspective that characterizes the theoretical approach of Western philosophy. And what remains is not the human being in its solitude, but the solitude of the transcendental ego immediately filled by the presence of the alter ego, as we are reminded in the fifth Cartesian meditation. So what is the transcendental ego? According to Husserl, through the epoché, it becomes clear that the ego is the one in whose life the perception of a human being is kept within the universal perception of the sense of being of the world. The crucial question arises then of whether reduction to the ego eliminates Mensch as Mensch in der Welt, the human being as being in the world. Husserl hastens to point out in the lecture and the examination that the world remains a fundamental theme and that it is not eliminated but subtracted from the naivety of everyday knowledge. In this text, he is more committed to ensuring the possibility of justifying the correlation between the world and the subject then analyzing the structure of the human being. This structure was already had already been analyzed in Ideas 2, which Edith Stein transcribed from Husserl's manuscript. Among his published works, it is in fact the most complete text delineating a phenomenological anthropology. It is a new way of performing transcendental analysis that allows us to identify the flow of the lived experiences, their livedness, of which we are aware, of which we have awareness, and that can be understood as a tool for comprehension of the dimension of the subject. Here lies the novelty of phenomenological analysis with respect to the two traditional gnosiological accounts of Western philosophy. In fact, described essentially, this experience refers to the real structure of the human being. Hence, ideas one and ideas two are intimately connected and must be read as constantly referring to one another. If the first volumes aim to clarify the phenomenological method while delineating the domain proper to phenomenology, namely the transcendental dimension, understood as a locus that can reveal the sense of the quadnos regarding us, the second volume seeks to bring to light the constitution of a material nature to which belongs the body, that is the animal nature, which is intimately linked up with a psychic reality and a spiritual world. The personal I belongs to the spiritual world. I maintain this interpretation because I could find the same main points regarding the structure of the human being in the Husserlian originary texts, which are going to be published in a new edition of Ideas 2. Husserlian texts are not elaborated, but all the same, we find in them description of life, Seele, and Geist, that is living body, soul or psyche, and spirit, discovered and justified through the lived experiences, Erlebnisse. I think that reporting Husserl's analysis, Edith Stein was faithful to this text, even if she organized them according her own reading. But we must remember that she asked Husserl insistently to control her transcription, and he said he had no time to do it. It is interesting to note, after having breasted all the traditional views of the human being, the phenomenological analysis of it is approached in an original way. The method is not deductive, but ostensive, recovering and confirming the long-staying perspective of human being's tripartition. It is a tripartition in body, psyche, and spirit, which we find also in St. Paul, for example. The notion of life, the living body, is exquisitely phenomenological. The very structure of the human being comes to evidence from the examination of the living body, which is not in itself a starting point, rather, as we have heard from the paper of Sarah, for example, rather its characteristics are traced by moving from the presence of perception as an experience of which we are aware. If perceptual apprehension presupposes the contents of sensation, which play a necessary role for the constitution of appearing of a real thing, it implies the fact that the body is involved in a freely moved sense organ, and all that is thingly real is in the surrounding world of the ego, it has its relation to the body. This quotation is from the Ideas pertaining to a pure phenomenology. Also, a sui generis transcendental structure is delineated to allow us to come on to an investigation of the human being as nature, the living body, as a bear of localized sensations, as crossed by the sensation of a pleasure, pain, well-being, or discomfort, which constitutes the material base of nature. Husserl defined this base as hialetic, and this description is according to me, very, very important. That is, it serves as the ground for the constitution of values. Therefore, the intentional functions are connected with this original layer so that psychophysical matter can take on spiritual functions. There also exists a qualitative distinct dimension, namely psyche. The living body is intertwined with psyche. Some Husserlian manuscripts analyze further exploring the dimension of psyche, the realm of instincts, which indicates a continuity with the animal world. However, this domain is distinguished from the one marked by intentional and spiritual function. These are voluntary, evaluative, theoretical acts that characterize the human person. In this way, one enters in the life of the spirit, which is not determined, but motivated. And it is the seat of the free acts and the rational standpoint. Passivity and activity intertwine, but activity characterizes the awake or wakeful human being who is ethically and theoretically awake. We proceed therefore to definition of the person who has the representations, feels, evaluates, purchases something, acts. And in each of these personal acts, she, he stands in relation to some end with the surrounding object of her, his world. Taking a personalistic attitude, and we can find also the expression or the description of the person in the new in the text that are going to be published, for example, on page 551. We find in the Geistigen Einstellung oder das Personal Subjekt ist aber nicht das bloße rein Ich, and so on. And taking this personalistic attitude towards the surrounding world means adopting an evaluative and ethical attitude. This, far from being artificial, is the real natural attitude. This is one of the few places where the term natural is used by Husserl, for he usually excludes it because he attaches it to the use that positivism makes of it in the context of naturalism. Certainly, Husserl's position is not a substantialistic position. All this far from his mental horizon. I say so in connection with Edith Stein, and I'll say something later about this point. All this is far from his mental horizon for a series of reasons. His scientific training, his personal approach to philosophy, which is without ties to a particular current of thought, his belonging to the Protestant cultural world in conflict with medieval philosophy, and for his rejection of the rationalistic metaphysics of the modern age. However, as is well known, he is introduced in philosophy through Brentano, a former Catholic priest, an Austrian philosopher who is heir to ancient and medieval thought and a supporter of a rigorous philosophy open to the new demands of psychology. In Husserlian anthropology, we can in fact now use the expression, much space is dedicated to the ethical religious dimension. Undoubtedly, the gnosiological aspect in Husserl's research reveals, and it certainly is important as a way to solve all problems, but this in no way means that he has set aside his private research into ultimate and supreme problems, which he defines metaphysical, as he states in one of his most important works, namely Cartesian Meditation. So I go to to say something about the Husserl and metaphysical question. The term metaphysics has many meanings in Husserl. We pause briefly just to note that he distinguishes historically degenerate metaphysics and the metaphysics that has originally found as first philosophy. The former refers to an investigation rooted in excess of speculation, whereas the latter refers to the authentic spirit of Greek philosophy as Aristotle largely understood it. However, the reference here to first philosophy is not linked with Plato or Aristotle, but also to Leibniz's metaphysics, in particular to the notion of a monad. For Husserl, there is only one objective world that is identifiable through what he calls transcendental metaphysics, which demonstrates how, departing from the subject, one can understand the constitution of an objectively existing world. I have called this position Husserl, which places together terms traditionally considered opposed to one another, such as transcendental ego and objective existence of the world, transcendental realism. He maintains that it is precisely the passage to otherness, always through a lived body, that guarantees an existing objective world. This possibility grounds transcendental realism, and we find this expression in Husserl. Husserl sees his new metaphysical point of view as valid because it is not a question of a metaphysical construction linked only to a tradition, but a position justified on the basis of intuition, which tends to explicate the sense of the world, the sense the world, this world has for all us. Following this line of analysis, which tends to emphasize the sense of the existing reality in which we find ourselves immersed and defined as metaphysics of immanent realities, that is, the I and the world, Husserl then moves on to analyze the metaphysics of absolute transcendence. I have identified six argumentative ways in which Husserl writings, in Husserl writings, that leads to the metaphysical question of God. First, the objective way of finality that recalls the fifth theological way of Thomas Aquinas. Second, the subjective way that departs from Augustine and Ansel. Third, the intersubjective or Leibnizian way, which leads to the ultimate monad. Fourth, the way to hyletics, which is always a theological way that starts from the deep dimension of reality that are pre-reflexive and pre-categorial and which manifest the presence of the presence of an order. An order of things. Fifth, the way through ethics. Sixth, perhaps a mystical way that deepens the presence of God in our interiority. I am unable here to discuss at length this way, and we cannot treat here the ethical question themes present in Husserl's work. I only observe that Husserl's treatment of ethical issue is in some case connected to religious theme, and as I said above, there is no ethical way. There is an ethical way that leads to God, and we have especially some interesting analysis in the Grand Problem effort. The second part of my speech is linked up with Edith Stein and her acceptance of the phenomenological method and the analysis of the human person. Edith Stein, contra Husserl, accepts Schiller's terms, philosophical anthropology, though she generally follows Husserl's description of the human person in her early phenomenological works. Here, I would like to demonstrate the centrality of human beings for Stein's phenomenology. Inspired by the investigation of her teacher, in particular those of Ideas 1, Edith Stein chose the theme of her dissertation. As we know, the concept, we have already spoken about this point, the concept of knowledge of the other through a deepening of meaning, of the meaning of the particular act that we constantly perform, namely Einfühlung, which we can translate with the term empathy or entropy. I prefer entropy because it is more specific regarding Husserl's and Edith Stein's analysis. At the beginning of her dissertation, Stein takes up the fundamental aspect of the Husserlian method by distinguishing the central characteristics of the various experiences she explores. And here I refer to the vital force, vital power, but I, you have already heard what Valentina told to us, and I think this is a particular novelty in Edith Stein's position. And regarding the sphere of the psychic sphere, this sphere is structured according to a sort of a causality as relations among psychic events that can be considered deterministic to a certain extent. But it is but is this very causality the only source of direction of the human being? The feeling fresh or tired of the psyche, for example, is always and exclusively the basis of our actions and therefore of our decisions, or are there also choices that refer to the reason which reveals a different source of decisions? It is here that the sphere of the spirit geist becomes manifest. From a philosophical point of view, the presence of the human being in the dimension of the spirit allows us to affirm that the human being is a person. Their foremost position will remain fundamental for Edith Stein, even when her research turns to ancient and medieval thought. Indeed, it will help confirm her later phenomenological analysis, especially in the work structure of the human person and the finest and eternal being. So we can just say something shortly about Edith Stein's metaphysical questions. She passes seamlessly from phenomenological analysis to metaphysical position. The subject is not only a poor eye, psychic eyes, and spiritual eyes, but also substance. The complex layer map of the inner life is completed by the presence of a nucleus, as we have already have a core already identified in Stein's phenomenological analysis, and now defined by her as the soul of the soul, a deep point of a convergence of the human being and the place of opening towards transcendence constituted by others and God. And here it's possible to speak about the way in which Edith Stein reflects on the existence of the world. And in this case, Stein's attitude is unique. She repeats several times that the proofs and demonstrations do not help find faith, for example, they validate faith, they validate faith, but they did not lead to faith. The believer, that is the one who already has faith understood as the knowledge of God, allows him herself to lead by various proofs or texts. The non-believer remains on the border. The thinker who applies the rules of natural knowledge shrink back again and away from the lips over the abyss, she said. This does not mean that faith is an irrational fact. On the contrary, Stein maintains that the fetus that accept the revelation can, indeed must, help natural reason acquire the knowledge of the truth. In this sense, reason enlightened by faith becomes supernatural reason, an expression that Stein uses only in her comparative essay on Husserl and St. Thomas, but which in an important sense she always keeps present because it serves to delimit the boundaries of a human reason while accepting the possibility to become stronger through faith. If philosophy wants to reach the truth, it must recognize the different sorts of truth, including revelation.